probably 10 of those in the state. So hard to get there. Remember, a couple hundred, there's about 40, 50 deputy wardens, there's 18 wardens, there's only 10 administrative captains.
What you gotta do to get up there?
They just don't, when you get to a certain level facility, they just don't have that many people who need it. So a lot of other places, a lot of other facilities, they don't have an admin captain. An admin captain is a special role at your bigger facilities. Alright, don't get too caught up in it, so. So you guys wanna be officers, so how are you gonna get started? What you're actually gonna look for is the website, Department of Administrative Services, statewide exam. The exam announcement will come out. They'll say, we need correction officers, we need state police, we need protective service officers. Those are the officers who work at like the college campuses and stuff. You'll go and you'll hear the exam announcement. You can go to your library, you can go online, and you basically will go there and you'll fill out an application. And that'll register you to take the test. Go ahead.
If we enter an age.
Next, good question. Qualifications, this is for DOC. Each local and state might have a little varying, but this is for the State Department of Corrections. You have to have your high school diploma, or you have to have GED. Have to have it, okay? You gotta be at least 21 years old. When I started, you could have been 18. Maximum security prison, you could have been 18 years old working. Right? General good health, you gotta be able to breathe, in essence. All right? Good work record. They don't want you to see like you're fired all the time. No felony convictions in the U.S. citizen. This is the key. For working in the Department of Correction, you have to be able to work first, second, or third shift. What's first shift? You guys guess?
First
shift? First shift.
Is it 7 to 3?
7 to 3. Second shift? 3 to 11 or 4 to 12. Third shift is night shift. Midnight to 8 a.m., 11 to 7, something like that. So you gotta be willing to work that kind of shift. You work 365 days a year, 24 hours a day, holidays and weekends. So you have a rotating schedule, but does the prison ever close?
No.
No. So we need people there every single day, every single minute.
So you guys are always hiring?
A lot. Usually a lot. You're considered an essential employee. I don't know if you ever heard on the radio. Non-essential employees don't need to come to work today because it's snowing. You are an essential employee. Us, state police and fire, are the people on the road when everybody else closes. When they had that 9-day shutdown a while back, a couple years back, the whole state was closed. Guess who was still at work?
You were still at work?
Still at work. Slept there.
Sucks.
Slept there. Got paid to sleep there. And your starting salary is about $40,000 per year with benefits.
Oh, shit.
All right, that's about $22 an hour.
I didn't make that job.
The hiring process, what you're going to go through to get hired, all right? You're going to hear about the announcement. You're going to apply application online. You're going to take a written test. It's like a civil service test. You can practice them at the library. They'll have civil service exam, law enforcement exam. It's the same kind of thing. It's like taking a written exam. There'll be comprehension, English, math, that kind of stuff. A basic test that you have to take and pass, okay? You're going to have an interview. They're going to conduct a background check. They're going to go around and ask all kinds of questions. Go ahead.
So the interview, they call you or?
They call you and it's a panel interview. Usually they call you down to the academy. There's an academy down in Cheshire. They sit you down. One person is from human resources. Another person is from the custody aspect, an actual supervisor, and they ask you questions. Right. Medical evaluation, you'll just go and get like a physical, right? And then you'll go to the academy. You spend about 6 to 10, depends on, they change it a lot. Sometimes it's 10 weeks, sometimes it's 8 weeks, sometimes it's 16 weeks. But they go, and you go to like an academy, almost like a boot camp. Except
so
they're not yelling and screaming at you. There's no, you go on first shift, it's Monday through Friday. And they're in essence, it's like going to school again. They're giving you the basic legal requirements that they have to educate you so that you can work in a prison.
All right. Oh, so you don't go like workouts and all that?
No, no. I mean, they encourage
it's like school.
It's not. Yeah, it's like school. It's not like the army. There's no one going to be yelling and screaming at you and do sit-ups and push-ups. It's not that kind of academy. The state police is like that, but not Department of Correction. And after that, you'll go on a working test period. It's 9 months. So from the academy until 9 months later, we get to check you out. If we don't like what we see, we say no thank you. All right.
Do you get paid during that?
You get paid during that 9 months. So this, after you graduate the academy, this is my facility. This is McDougall Walker Correctional Institution. Right? This big building up here is the McDougall building. This small building down here, that was the Walker building. They're one big
Walker?
Facility. Huh?
The Walker?
Walker Building down here. So McDougal Building, we have about 2,200 inmates there. It's a maximum security facility. This is where I spent my whole 22 years.
On this one, in this one?
No, in both, combined. I actually was an officer here. They were two separate facilities my first 8 years. Then I got promoted to this building. And then about a year and a half later, they combined them. They made them one facility. So the officers just go back and forth. The inmates are different. All right? So 2,200 inmates. There's about 500 officers. Total about 800 staff members, but 500 of those are officers. There's 35 lieutenants. There's about 10 captains, 3 deputy wardens, 1 warden. That's who work at just this one facility.
The warden was getting money.
Yeah, normal warden's about 110 to 120 up to 140.
An hour?
No, a year.
A year? Oh.
A year. So in this building, in the Builder Building, there's about 15 to 1,600 inmates. All right. This is a max long-term facility. So guys with lots of time, maximum security, guys who come here who die. All right. They literally are sentenced when they're 18 years old, they never leave. They're sentenced when they're 20 years old, they never leave. Some guys come in and out, but everybody has to have 2 or more years. If you don't have 2 or more years, you won't go to this facility. All right. Working in this facility, per shift a day, there's about 4 lieutenants. 4 lieutenants cover about 100, 120 officers. And again, 1,500 inmates. That's normal staff ratio that you're used to dealing with. The Walker Building is a smaller building. There's only about 500, 550 inmates. You have 2 lieutenants, 1 captain. So for the management of that, and you have about 50 officers. McDougal Walker. In essence, the easiest way to think of McDougal Walker Correctional Institute, to think about working there, is you'd be wasted. Consider yourself working it in the city. What does a city have? Anything a city has, name it.
A lot of people.
A lot of people. We got a lot of people. We got 2,200 inmates, 800 staff. What else?
Walls,
buildings. Huh?
Buildings?
Yep, we got the buildings. We have that. You saw the big picture of the building. Do we have a medical?
Yep.
We got a full hospital.
Hospital.
With a hospice unit. That means hospice people are dying, you can die right in prison. All right, we have full schools. School, you can get your GED. We'll have you get your GED. Carpentry. Commissary. We're like a little city. Okay? That's how you got to think of us. And that's where you will work. Okay? This is actually, if you can see this better, guys. Is that better?
Yes.
So this is the entryway into an actual housing unit. This is an actual picture of McDougal Walker. This is M unit right now. M unit is Michael unit. That's all designated with Geach, so you know where you are working. I'm going to say to one of you, hey, you got M1 control today. Go to M1 control. You're going to monitor the inmates in M1 control. All right?
That's that unit.
And that's that unit. You're going to walk in here. This is M1, so M106. The other side is M2.
What's it guy do?
This is all male prison.
I have a question.
Go ahead, hon.
So you know for like guys that are like,
yep.
Are they in there too, but like in a different, like?
Nope, they're out. They're out.
With the guys?
Yep.
Wait, so like,
because I watch this TV show and like they have the, like, them separated from like the guys.
Nope.
Is it beyond scared straight?
No.
Wait. So, if you're like a transgender, like,
yep.
You remove like everything, like.
The PC world of like making all these is kind of exceptions and what everybody is and what everybody is and all that kind of stuff. You gotta think one thing about prison. Prison kind of stays old culture. Okay, we don't really adapt to that thing. We have one thing that determines whether you go to a male facility or not.
Yeah,
and we can all imagine what that one thing is unique.
Your private part.
Your private part. Okay, if you have a private part, no matter what else you have, if you still have a private part that makes you a man, you're going to a male facility. And that's easy how we do it, okay? So here's your housing unit. This is where you would work. That's your bunk. That's an actual picture of your bunk. That's where the officer sits. There's one officer who works the desk. That's called the desk. There's one officer who's called the rover who just roves around. He literally just walks around. As you're working that day, there'll be 96 guys in here. All right? So about 48 cells, 2 guys to each cell. And this is where you would spend your 8 hours. See, M1 control, M1 rover. That's where I would put you. And your job would be to go in as those 2 officers. And you want to do what with the inmates? What do you think your job is basically?
Overwatch them, yeah.
Watch them. So we monitor, track, and count. What does that sound like? For $22 an hour. In essence, that's what you do as a correctional officer.
You never seen the show Us?
No, I don't watch any prison shows. I watch it every day. I didn't have to watch any of the prison shows because I just had to drive to work. All right. So go to the next slide. So that's a typical cell.
What the fuck? That's just dirty as shit.
So these are where two guys are going to live. You can see they got their toilet right there. They got their beds. They got their TV.
So these bathrooms right next to each other.
Welcome to life in prison.
Oh my God.
That sucks.
Yeah.
So.
There's nurses there?
Yep, we have full medical unit.
That really sucks. You get to whip it up right in front of your friend.
No, they need different, right? I mean, like the bedsheet.
They cannot hang anything. That's against the rules.
So when they shower,
we have to have visual. As an officer, sorry, as an officer, we need constant visual observation.
I'm going to say, like, in front of their friend, like the beds, like, do they do that?
No. Do they do it? Yes. Are they supposed to? No. Normally, if we're in the cell together and it's me and him, and I got to do my thing, I'm going to take a sheet and I'm going to tie it from here over to here. And it's going to have to bow. And that's a respectful thing to do with the officer. He can still see my buddy on the other side, but it gives me the privacy. A lot of times that's why you'll see something hanging like that, the sheets hanging like that. But these two guys actually are be more of the slobs of a cell. They're probably not long-term guys. If it was two long-term guys, their stuff would be squared away. It wouldn't look like that. So that's a typical cell. You'd be walking by that cell, making sure two guys are in there, walking around. Go ahead.
That's the shower?
That's the shower right there.
And it's in a different like place?
Oh, no.
No. If you go back to the main room, go back to one more. You can't see it. We're looking, that's looking back here. I just took a picture this way. If I turn around and take a picture this way right now, basically this wall, you're looking at the showers. So they're right up, go to a head now. So these stairs coming down, I just took a picture looking at the room this way. Now I just turn around. So that's the only privacy they get. There's 96 guys, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 showers. There's an open toilet, and you see, you can tell, there's a laundry room right there.
You can do laundry anymore?
No, there's a laundry man, there's a laundry schedule. So, but everything, as you can see, pretty much right there, besides the school, everything is there for them to live. The food, if you look back to the tables, the food, they eat right there. The food comes right in, the guys eat right here. When you're a monetary rec, when they come out for recreation, when they come out for things, it's half at a time. So you're dealing with about 48 inmates at a time.
For an hour?
It varies. The schedule varies. All right? This is the new wing. This is the construction. It was that big, long, green circular thing. I mean, roofs. It's just a newer facility. There's two officers down here. There's just more inmates. There's 120 inmates in that thing. But same thing. Here's your tables where they eat. Here's where you're going to sit in the bubble. If you're the rover, here's where you're going to walk around. And you're required to do tours. They call them tours. So every half hour, if I'm on a tour, I'm just walking around. You can have guys, just what you're doing right now besides cell phones. I'm a CO right now.
Hey, what's up?
How you guys doing? What's up? All right. They can be playing cards.
Do you interact with them? Like, you can have friends in there? Like,
they're out. This is a fully working institution. So it's not like the movies.
Do you have friends that are inmates? Like
I grew up with guys, so I know them inside there. But you always it's think of a teacher student. There's always that line.
I have a question.
Go ahead.
Have you ever seen somebody get suicide?
Yes.
Have you?
That's crazy.
Yes.
And like,
or stabbed.
Stabbed.
Hmm? Stabbed.
Wait, you get stabbed?
Yes.
Have you ever gotten hit before?
Yes.
So, like, when people are acting up,
don't you
have, like, send them to, like, solitary?
Say that again?
When, like, people are, like, acting out and
stuff,
don't you have
them to, like, solitary? Restrictive housing. But as an officer, that's what you would deal with. You'd have a radio, you would have keys, and all you wear is a body alarm. It's like a button that you press that says, I need help. But no baton, no gun, no nightstick, there's none of that. We don't wear
anything. I thought you did have that.
No, none of that.
Whipping everybody up.
Basically, if I was going to work right now, I would have my little utility belt, I'd put my radio on, I'd have these key protectors, these things that hook the keys.
Yeah, like Mr. Davis has, right?
Yes, he has a key protector. That's it, and let's go. Let's go to work.
You should be throwing hands with him? You be throwing hands?
What do you mean throwing hands?
Like fighting.
Like,
as an officer, If you have to physically get involved with an inmate because he's being interrupted, yes, it's a hands-on procedure. But that's...
So you got to know how to fight. You can't be no bitch.
You have to know how to handle yourself. You have to know how to handle yourself. It has to be able to stay in shape. If you have a kind of, you know, like a background in the martial arts and stuff like that, a lot of guys have that. If you have a background in military, a lot of guys have that.
That's pretty cool.
How about when they do, like, the cell checking? Do you guys do that, like, every week?
Every half hour.
Like,
oh, for real? You can just
no,
check?
I mean, like, search inside the cell. Like,
you got to do two a day. Two a day, your shift. You're mandated to go into every cell. You pick two cells that you want to do as an officer, and you go in, and it's called your talk.
Is it like in the movies, you throw everything in the
floor? And then what is it called, the thing that you guys do every 6 months? Which is, like, you guys go in...
A shakedown?
Yeah, everything.
Right, you clear all the inmates out, you put them in the gym, you go through all their stuff.
Yeah, that's every six months.
That's what
it depends on the facility. Our facility was four times a year because it was maximum security.
And the inmates don't stay in the same cell. You guys always change.
You can't move them around. You can't move. But no, we'll have guys who stay in the same cell for year after year after year after year.
So if they ask you, they want to go different, would you let them look at different
this year too? They actually write a request to their housing unit manager, which is kind of like each housing unit manager is like a boss of that unit.
So how about the counselor? What is the counselor like?
The counselor handles like all of their stuff in terms of how much time they're supposed to be there, their good time, their calculation of good time, their calculation of like when they're up for parole, and then contacts out in the community, helping them make contacts if they're going to get to that, or the visiting, how they're arranging their visiting, their phone calls with their family. Their money on the books. You take care of all that.
Oh, and it's true if you like death row, right?
No, death row is there's no death row at my facility. Not at my facility.
What is that?
Death row?
Death row is technically, legally right now, not to get too much into it, but Connecticut, they got rid of death row. But the problem is there is that they don't know what to do with those guys. They're worried they'll actually, if they bring a lot of them into the prison population, that they'll get killed. Like the Cheshire guys. That kind of stuff. People who did harm to kids,
but people
did harm to females. A lot of those guys did harm to females. So.
There's a prison code, right?
No, prison code.
Yeah.
There's a prison code.
So, one guy in the shower.
One guy in the shower.
So, nobody in 22 years.
Well,
he came in like, he was like 18.
You can easily get his foot.
See how that door swings?
Yeah.
So you take your shower? It's hard to see. There's a wall here with a window. So you as an officer, you wouldn't be required. I mean, you're going to give them their privacy and their respect unless they do something in the shower that you have to do.
So the fish would be like, oh.
Right. I mean, there's two guys. You know, we only allow one guy in the shower. So if there's two guys in the shower, then the officer's going to go in there.
You got to let them be, yeah?
No, we don't have to let them be. All right, if you go to the next, I'll show you. This is basically a school, like I told you, it's a full school.
About if you are like engaged to someone or like married and she comes to the prison, like is it true like you get a room? And you
No, that you're talking about conjugal visits. Conjugal visits aren't allowed any longer. There was a time that they had conjugal visits. That if you were a lifer, it means that you're going to spend your entire life and you actually were married, your wife, there was a spot inside the prison, there's a room. They actually came in and, you know, they brought
they
stuff.
They still do that?
And handed the thing. You know.
They don't do it anymore. There, I say no, the program stopped, but there's lifers who were in the program until they pass, until they die. They still get that. But when I left, it was down to like four or five guys. Still meeting with their wife and stuff like that.
I have a question. You know, when you go visit someone in jail, why do like some guys get to have like, you know, visiting like touching when you
could tell? Yeah, we have full contact.
And why some people have like two of them?
So the two separate buildings, the bigger building, because it's considered a working prison. So the guys there, if you imagine, like you said, when you get in trouble, our average guys who got in trouble who were put into our restrictive housing unit. So say we're working officers and you call me up, I'm the supervisor, you say, hey, I got this guy, he's wild now, come get him, because he's just acting a fool. So I call him, hey, come with me, I'm going to put you in a restricted. It's the same cell, it's just under restricted housing. We go down to 15-minute watches, there's an officer in there, but he's isolated now. There's only one or two guys in that cell.
Just him. It's just
and it's
him.
Restricted. That's where the restricted, he's not, he doesn't get to go to school, he doesn't get to have rec, he doesn't get to go to the gym.
It's like when you get a process in the...
Right.
You get in a restricted cell.
You get a referral, except here, we're going to put you in this classroom all by yourself with other guys who got referrals.
So basically, like ISS.
Right, like ISF, just like that. Same thing.
It's like a big cell and everybody goes in there.
Right, and that's it. But you're not going to a different facility, you're staying there. But now, if you imagine, out of the 1,500 inmates who go there, who are at that facility, we only had about 15 in SEG at a time. So, segregation. So out of that 1,500 inmates, if we only have 15, 10 guys in SEG, what are the other guys doing? The other guys are doing the right thing, right? They're getting up, they're making their bed, they're picking up their house, they're going to school, they're going to work, they're doing what they're supposed to do.
They'll tell you everything, like when to get up, when to shave, when to shower.
I can tell you right now, if you want to know the schedule, I can tell you right now. At 7:05 is first shift, that's first count. All right. They had it this morning at 7:05, they took first count. First count was literally, we lock all the inmates up, we put them in their cell, the officers walk around with a sheet of paper. He goes to every single door, 1-2, 1-2. If you want to work Department of Correction, you only need to know three numbers, 0-1-2. That's the highest you got to add to, 0-1-2, 0-1-2. And then add up all the ones and twos and see what that equals, 96. So that way we track, what's that number? We track every single inmate at 7:05. 8 o'clock they come out, we have work call. So now the facility's ready to work. Okay? So we have work call, school call, commissary call. So they basically go to their jobs.
They get paid like 25 cents an hour, right?
Keep flipping. One more. There it is. 75 cents a day for a barber. Certified job class if you're a clerk, janitor, if you work in the kitchen, 75 cents a day. So you're my janitor.
And you get by, like, you gotta make hella days.
Well, the commissary and everything costs less. But this is what you get paid.
That's why you go in as a correctional officer.
Right. 75 cents a day, $22 an hour. You guys can kind of decide.
You get paid to be a student?
You get paid to be a student. If you don't have your GED at my facility, you get paid 75 cents a day.
And how much
are you paying? Now going on with the schedule, so from about 8 until about 10:30 comes, we're going to have breakfast. Everybody back to the housing unit, now we're going to have breakfast. Now we're going to have lunch. Lunch is served from basically 10 to 11, now we're going to lock you up again, because now staff has to serve. So at 12 o'clock, we're going to take you, count you again. Everybody locked up again. At 1 o'clock, we're going to let you out, you're going to work till about 3 o'clock. 3 o'clock, guess what? You're going to go back to your cell, you're going to lock up. Now the shift changed. Now I have the officers come in, the officers come out, second shift's going to come out. Right, as soon as the officer come on, guess what we're going to do?
Count.
We're going to count the inmates. And that, once they're done counting, we're going to feed them. 4:30, we're going to have dinner. Dinner's going to be over about 5:30, 6 o'clock. Then, at 6 o'clock, till about an hour and a half later, one tier is going to wreck. And then from there, it goes on to the next tier. 10 o'clock, everybody's locked up. Guess what we do?
Count.
We count. Now third shift's coming on. They start about 11 o'clock. Third shift starts at 11 a.m. What are we going to do? At 11 p.m., what are we going to do?
You still got to check them when they're sleeping?
Still got to check them. Ed, you're going to actually count them more when they're sleeping than when they're not.
You never seen a prison break? That's what.
Right. So third shift, basically as a third shift officer, you're going to see that same room. You're going to be there by yourself, though you're not going to have a partner because there's all the doors locked. They're going to be locked up. And you're going to count at 11. You're going to count at 1. You're going to count at 3. You're going to count at 5. You're paid to stay up. So you'd have to be
up. You don't have nobody to talk to.
Say
it again?
I said, like, they don't have nobody to talk to. You can be on your phone, right?
No cell phones allowed.
No, like, you officers, like.
No, you can't bring a phone.
That sucks. So you just.
You have your hardline phone and you have the other officers.
That's not jokes.
I mean, you get a half hour long.
Think about being a nurse. Same thing, basically. You have night shift. You don't have a cell phone on you, probably.
That gotta suck, because at night, you just...
I want to let you guys know, when you work in a facility, it's especially a maximum security facility, it can be a very scary environment. I can't tell you it's not. It is. It's not a normal thing. It's not a normal thing to drive to a prison. Think about how you become an inmate. How do you become an inmate?
Like killing someone.
Right, you break the law, right? So you break the law. What happens after you break the law?
You get processed.
Well, the first thing we gotta do is what? You broke the law, but now what happens?
You go to court.
Well, before you go to court, something's gotta happen. The police gotta get you, right? So the police come and get you. After the police come and get you, now what happens?
You go to court.
You go to court. What happens when we go to court?
They decide whether or not
you get judged.
Okay, so you get judged, right? You get judged. Once they say you found guilty, where are they gonna send you?
Prison.
rest. Jay, how do you get there?
In a bus with other people.
And how do you look like when you're in that bus?
Like, it's like strapped like that, yeah.
Right?
Can't even walk.
So sheriffs are going to actually chain you up, put you in handcuffs and leg irons. They're going to put you on a bus, and they're going to drive you to prison. And you're going to stay in that prison forever, how long that sheet of paper says you're going to stay. A couple years, right? So now you guys tell me. When I got up, I took a shower. I put my uniform on. I got my car. I stopped and got my Dunkin's. And then I drove to the prison. And I did that for 22 and a half years. So you had the inmate who had to be chased, caught, sentenced, then put in chains, and driven to the building and left in the building. And then you had me who got up every day, put my uniform on, and drove there. Now I got one question for you. Who's crazy?
You.
And that's our joke, all right? Yes, we're the ones who are crazy because we didn't have to get chained up to go there. It's a good job. Now, why do you want to be corrections? Because of the benefits. The benefits are that good. So what's your actual schedule?
It's a hard job, too.
It's a difficult, like stressful job, but you're going to work for 5 days, and then you're going to have 3 days off, and then that's going to rotate. Is
vacation?
Everyone?
Like,
huh?
If you like, want to like, want vacation.
15 days a year vacation, and you get to bank it, up to 60 days. Same thing with holidays. You work holidays, they give you time in the book. But for those 5 days, so say the first week we lucked out, we're going to work Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, right? On, say, second shift. Then we're going to get Saturday, Sunday, Monday off. Our next week starts, we're going to work Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. Then we're going to get Sunday, Monday, Tuesday off. It just keeps going and going and going and going. Now, seniority.
You have a different schedule every week.
Right. Your schedule rotates it. So some weeks you have Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday off. The next week you have Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday off. The next week you have...
You get Saturday off? Never?
It rotates.
You have 3 days a week off at all times?
3 days a week. You work for five, you get 3 days a week off. Think about that. 3 days a week off. When I was an officer and then a lieutenant, I was on that five. So for almost 18 years, I did 5 days on, they call it 3 days off. You know what hurt me, killed me, was to go to that 5-2 schedule. To go to Monday through Friday with only Saturday, Sundays off, I was like, this is crazy. I drove to the store, I was like, look at all these people. This Saturday, I called my wife. I said, no, I'm not staying. I'll come back on Tuesday night. I can't take this. Because all the people are there. If you have Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday off.
Everything's empty.
Everything's empty. And you can do whatever you want to do.
You can do your shopping. Like, just
right? Now, you get tight with other people because if we all have Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday off and we want to, you know, we're young and we want to have fun. Well, who else?
Can't do shit.
Who else has Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday off? Only us. So you get very friendly with each other. You get to know each other very well. You spend a lot of time together. Your proximity of friends and stuff gets smaller and smaller like that. Because we're the only ones with Wednesday, Thursday, Friday on second shift.
When you apply for a job, like, do they pick the shift or you could choose which shift you
want? That's an excellent question. Everything now is once you get hired, you're gonna get what's called employee number. My number was 562-277. Okay? That was my state employee number. Right? So that means they assign you that number. So I'm 562-277. Let's make it simple. 277. We all just got hired. We're about to start the academy. They're going to walk in the room, and they're going to say, here you go. Here's your paperwork. Here's everything. Oh, by the way, you need to learn this number. He's 277. She's 278, 279, 280, 281, 282, 283, 284, 285. Okay? So that's basically your seniority number. So now I have the lowest number, so I have the most seniority. So now we're inside... Get to our facility, and you're going to meet up with the admin captain, and he's going to say, hey, I got some good news and I got some bad news for you all. Right? We just hired 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I got 8 positions. 4 of them I need on third shift, and 4 of them I need to work second.
So you got a choice. You got to take whatever it comes.
Well, no, the first thing I'm probably going to do is say to you, third shift. And no hands go up. Nobody wants third shift. Now I'm going to look at you and go, what's your number? 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 And guess who has the lowest 4 numbers? Seniority. Because you have that lower number, you have higher seniority technique. Even though you started on the same day, you're in the same class, if everything's by that number. So to make it fair, and that's how everything is simplistic and fair, we're always just going to use our seniority number. So these 4 would have got second shift because they got lower number. you four would have got third shift. But so now,
the highest, the less area you got.
Right, it's hard to understand. But now think about it. Every quarter of the year, you can ask to be transferred by that seniority number. So you might stand 4 months.
You're number one.
Number one? He doesn't exist anymore. He doesn't exist anymore.
All right, so just the numbers.
Now that's the same thing with you want to transfer to another facility, you want to transfer to another shift. Everything is based upon that number, your seniority number. And as the longer you stay, what do you earn? You earn more seniority. So if you want a time off, you want Christmas off, right? Everybody wants Christmas off because you got to work Christmas. You all give me sheets saying, Mark, Captain Garvin, take me off for Christmas. I'm going, okay, give me all the sheets. Oh, I got two spots. Guess what I'm going to use to figure out when I get this Christmas off?
Lowest number.
That's seniority number. So everything is based upon seniority. That gets back to that paramilitary organization, right? And who gets what? It kind of takes things apart. So it doesn't matter that I know you, doesn't matter that you're my cousin, doesn't matter that you used to be my uncle. You're going to walk up and go, yeah, I know she, your uncle's a warden. I don't care. I put in for Christmas. I got more time than you. Oh, yeah, you're right. You do. So you get Christmas, I don't. Next year, maybe I'll have more time. So seniority for officers, for staff is everything. Any other questions? And that's how you get assigned your shift. That's how you get assigned your facility. It's basically luck of the draw. I got assigned maximum security prison. I went and looked at other prisons. I went and looked at the female prison. Not for me.
What do you think is what's the
females are worse?
The easiest way to describe it is when I was between 20 and 25, I loved second shift.
Right? You got the whole night off, just go party.
I'm out at 11, I'm young, I'm having fun, I'm not married, I have no kids, and what can I do in the morning?
Sleep.
I can sleep. Right? Now, first or third shift, that's called the working man shift, or that's called the daddy shift. I had enough seniority, I made it to day shift, but when I got promoted, I, of course, got put on second shift. Then I got promoted in 2001. My daughter was born in 2001. So I stayed on second shift for a little while, but once she got old enough to start, I started missing stuff, and she started missing daddy. I said, uh-oh, I went to third shift. I stayed on third shift, because what's she doing on third shift?
Sleeping.
She's sleeping. Right? And then she'd go to school. I wouldn't miss anything. I got off second shift with her.
Yeah, so it's perfect in the morning.
Right, it's personal preference of what's good for you. A lot of people, young, you know, I joked, oh, they went to second shift to have fun, that's what I did. I should have went to do what other guys did. They went to third shift, then they went to school. They finished out their school. So the state will basically help you get your degree. It's called the student buyback program. So if you go to a state school and the class costs $1,500, you pay the $1,500 for the class, you show the state that you passed the class, they give you $750 back.
This is $750?
They give you half.
Oh.
But if it costs you $10,000 to get a degree, what is the state going to do?
Give you five back.
Not too bad, right? And you're working, and you're getting paid. So most officers, in their first, second, third year, now, remember I told you we have about 120 officers who work day shift. 100 work day shift, 120 who work second shift, and about 100 who work third shift. So I'm the supervisor. You're working day shift. All of a sudden, everyone's calling out. I'm sick. Captain Garvin, I'm sick. my kids are sick. I'm taking time off. So now, you guys are working, right? I can't get anybody to work overtime, so what happens? I need 120 officers, no matter what.
You can do overtime?
Oh, yeah. You can do overtime.
Overtime, you get paid half of money?
You get time and a half. So think of it that way. If I'm making $20 an hour, and now you're going to pay me to work overtime, how much money am I going to make an hour?
It's a double.
Time and a half. 20 times time and a half. $30 an hour. So you can work day shift at regular pay, or second shift at time and a half. Most officers in the first couple years, I said they start about 40,000. Most break in about 80. You normally double your salary in overtime. Because a lot of times, like I said, you're mandated to work. Mandated to work means I call you up and say, hey, by the way, I'm holding you for tonight. You have to work second shift, or you have to work third shift, or you have to work day shift.
Fuck.
And some guys just go, that's good. I want the overtime. I want the money. Any other questions?
How you get ranked up, like from like restaurant officer?
It's the same. It's kind of the same process as you did when you got hired. So when I went to get promoted, it's changed over the years. But basically, you take a test, you go through an interview, and then you get picked. But it's the same thing. But like I said, it's very, remember, 5,000 officers, there's only a couple hundred lieutenants. It's probably the same as the state police. You probably, for the 200 to 300 people that we pick, 300, 400 people that we pick, you might get 5,000 applicants. So it's good to know people. It's good to, like I said, all those requirements that you need, a good work record, that's the key. One of the most important things that I want to know is I was in the position and I hired people. I went down and did those interviews. The most important thing that we wanted to see is what?
No felonies.
No, not even that.
If they go to work again?
Are you going to come to work? I need you. Well, what do I need, right? Remember what we said? This prison closed?
You're reliable.
So I need you to come to work. So that was the most important thing that we looked at. Can you show me a record that you've been to work? And where you work, you went to work. And I'm going to call up that work and say, how is he, how is she? Well, you know what? Wasn't always the best, but they came. Oh, okay. They were work when they were supposed to be. They were work when they were supposed to be.
How about is that? That's your first job.
That was my basic first real job. I mean, I had all the summer jobs and stuff like that. That was my basic first job where I was getting health care and benefits and real money. I mean, I started at $14.79 an hour. But that doesn't seem like, but remember, minimum wage was only $5. $5 an hour. So that was back then, 93. When I started telling my friends I'm making $15 an hour, they were like, woo! Any other questions?
That's it.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.